person to you, Jim Felman, who will moderate this sentencing. Markman Felman has a distinguished 30-plus year career in criminal representation, has practiced before Congress, he's a sentencing commission, legal reform and policy reform issues. He's a past chair of the ABA criminal justice section. We're thrilled to have Jim here moderate this panel. So, thank you, Jim.
Great, thanks so much. And I guess if we can turn Jonathan's picture on, so Jonathan can be seen at least. Good morning, Jonathan. So good morning, everyone. This is a real pleasure and an honor to be here. I wanted to thank Brian McAvoy, Joe Whitley, Holly, the folks who put this together. I also love to recognize every time the staff at the ABA are out there, but Carol Rose and Virginia Ashton just do an incredible job. And so I thank them as well. We've got a wonderful panel this morning. Our first panelist I'm going to introduce you to is Commissioner Jonathan Wroblewski. Jonathan, unfortunately, was exposed to COVID over the weekend, and so earlier this week, he's fine, but felt he would not be prudent to travel. So we get Jonathan by Zoom. Jonathan is one of my favorite people to complain to in the Department of Justice. He is currently is the department's ex officio representative of the Columbia Sentencing Commission. He's also in charge of the Office of Policy and Legislation. And he's such a slouch that he also, in his free time, runs Harvard Law School's semester in Washington and occasionally teaches their sentencing conference up on the main campus. But Jonathan's background, he's a Duke undergrad, Stanford Law, he was a public defender for a while. He was on the staff of the commission for a while. He's been at the department for a very, very long time. And someone that I really think cares and is responsive, you can talk to him, he'll talk back. I'm really thrilled that Jonathan's been able to join us this morning. After Jonathan, we'll hear from Mary Price. Mary is Vice President and General Counsel of FAAM, formerly known as Families Against Mandatory Minimums. Mary's a Georgetown law grad, but more to the point, Mary is just a tireless policy advocate in this space. I think I've watched Mary now for at least two decades, maybe longer. And she just gets up every morning thinking, okay, what can I do to make the world a better place today, and does it through her organization, just tireless advocacy, and particularly more recently in the compassionate release space. So Mary's going to talk to us a little bit about compassionate release practice. And next we'll hear from Rebecca Brodey, who I really appreciate joined our program. I had Michael Dreeman lined up. Rebecca's all together with that. I think Michael, I'll tell Michael what I say. He had a conflict and was not able to come. Rebecca is the vice chair of or co-chair of our ABA Sentencing Committee. She's a partner at Cozen O'Connor in D.C. She's a graduate of Berkeley undergrad, Georgetown Law, and I just learned this morning that she also has a master's degree from the Sorbonne. So I'm even that much more impressed by it with Rebecca. She's also on the board of the Atlantic Innocence Project. And really, more to the point, what I will say about Rebecca again is sort of like Mary, in addition to her day job, she cares about making things better. So you're going to hear from Rebecca about a special project that she's working on that I think will help all of us considerably in the white collar space if she can pull it off. A database, basically, of variances and departures, which she'll talk to you a little bit more about that. So that's going to be the panel. I'm really going to talk with you a little bit about some of the First Step Act implementation issues. And if time allows, we'll have some questions at the end. Rebecca and I may also try to share a few practice pointers. Rebecca definitely will on how to handle your next sentencing here. So we'll go for a little while. Feel free, we'll try to be informal. If in the middle of what we're saying something hits you and you have a question, feel free to interrupt us, raise a hand, and we'll try to keep it informal. So with that, let me turn it over to Jonathan, and of course I think you all know we have a brand new sentencing commission that's getting ready to start up. So Jonathan, talk to us a little bit about what your job's looking like for the next year and what you're excited about.
Jim, thank you so much. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, we can.
Okay, great. Thanks so much for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be part of this panel. I apologize to all of you for not being in Georgia with you. As Jim said, we have a little bit of a topic of COVID in our home. So I thought it was best for everyone, for me to stay here. What I thought I would do is start off by just telling you a little bit about the Sentencing Commission and what I think is coming with the commission over the course of the next year or so. As many of you probably know, the commission has been without a quorum for almost 4 years, and that it's going to be 5 years between guideline amendments. Now, the commission has been collecting lots of data in the meantime. It's been producing lots of important reports. And by the way, I'm going to try to sprinkle in a couple of practice tips, if you can call it that, for the white collar world. And let me start here. One of the things the commission did during this period where they haven't had a quorum is they developed two important data tools, one called the Interactive Data Analyzer and one called JSON, which stands for something like the Judicial Sentencing Information Tool, something like that. For those of you who are not familiar with these tools, they're on the commission's website, and I really think they are worth a look. These tools can provide important information about how cases similar to yours are being sentenced across the country, and possibly can provide information that might be helpful for you in advocating before courts for a particular sentence. So I do think it's worth a look. The commission has some training videos on the JSON tool, so it can walk you through how to use it and what the output is. Now, since the commission has been without a quorum, a lot has happened. Just a couple of things I'll just mention. As Jim said, the Congress passed and President Trump signed the First Step Act. I think for a lot of people, the most important and far-reaching criminal justice reform legislation in the federal system in quite some time. We had a presidential election since the commission had a quorum. And interestingly, it's the first election that I am aware of where both candidates ran on a criminal justice reform agenda. We've had lots of legislation that's been enacted besides the First Step Act. There was firearms legislation most recently, but there's been lots of other legislation over the last 4 years that requires the commission to implement. Of course, we had the death of George Floyd in Minnesota. We've had a pandemic and lots of people on home detention, which is something we haven't seen before, and I'm not sure exactly what the implications of that will be. We've had an opioid crisis continue, and we've seen a sharp increase in violent crime and alien smuggling. Now, the new commission was confirmed in early August, just a few weeks ago, and we're thrilled about that because the commission, as I said, has a lot of work ahead of them. And what I thought I'd do first is just describe to you what the commission's amendment year looks like and what we're likely to expect from the commission over the course of the next 8 months or so. The Sentencing Reform Act, which you can find in Title 28 of the United States Code, it lays out a specific timetable for the commission to amend the sentencing guidelines. They can't do it all year long. They can only do it between the beginning of a Congress, roughly January 2nd, and the end of April. So they have a four-month window to amend the guidelines. But the Sentencing Reform Act also requires the commission to follow certain elements of the Administrative Procedures Act, not the entire act, but enough of it that it impacts their schedule. They have to publish proposed guideline amendments in the Federal Register. They have to open them up for public comment. They have to hold a public hearing. So there's a lot of process for them. So what I anticipate happening is that beginning sometime later this month, the commission will meet for the first time, and they will discuss among themselves what are their proposed priorities for this coming amendment here. And then they will publish in the Federal Register a list of those priorities and then open it up for public comment. And I'm sure many people will comment. And then probably in October, early November, they will finalize their priorities for the coming year. And they will begin work pretty quickly on trying to develop guideline amendments to address those priorities. And the reason I'm confident to move pretty quickly on that is because they have to publish April deadline that's set forth in the Act, they need to publish proposed guideline amendments in the Federal Register by December or January. That will give a 60-day period of comment, which takes us to roughly March. We'll hold a hearing in March, and then they will vote in April. So that's the sort of process that I anticipate the commission following. I'm not sure about it, but I'm fairly confident that's what we're going to see over the course of the next 6 to 8 months or so. Now, remember, once the commission votes in April on guideline amendments, they have to send it to Congress, and they sit in Congress, and if Congress does not act to reject what the commission has done, they go into effect 6 months later. And so you'll see your first new guidelines manual roughly November 1st of 2023. Again, that's what we anticipate happening in terms of process. Now, what are they going to do? Candidly, I'm not really sure, but let me give you some of the things that we are likely to suggest to them and some of the things that I think they're likely to at least think about and probably address. So the first thing is implementing legislation. Just a couple of months ago, when the new commissioners had their confirmation hearing, both Senator Durbin and Senator Grassley implored them to implement legislation that has been enacted by Congress over the last 4 years as one of their top priorities, and I think they are likely to do that. For example, the First Step Act made some changes. I know there was a panel on compassionate release earlier in this conference. The Congress made a significant change to compassionate release. It was only on its procedure, allowing defendants to file motions for compassionate release. But every circuit but the 11th Circuit has said that means the commission's current guideline does not apply to that situation, and so they need to address what is and isn't compassionate, appropriate elements for compassionate release. There are other parts of the First Step Act that I think they need to implement, including safety valve provision, which applies to drug offenders, and there's lots and lots of other legislation. This year, you all are aware that there was bipartisan gun legislation that was enacted. It includes new crimes, a directive to the commission, higher maximum penalties for felon in possession cases. I know most of you, this isn't your practice area, but there are thousands and thousands of gun cases that are prosecuted in the federal system. Now, there has been other legislation, including legislation that white-collar practitioners will want to be aware of, and those include legislation dealing with cybercrime, cryptocurrencies, export crimes. Whether the commission will take any of those issues up over the course of the next year or so, you know, I really don't know. There are other things that we are likely to raise with the commission and ask them to take up, again, sort of in this long list of things that have been piling up while they've been without a quorum. There are a number of operational issues that are causing wide disparities in sentencing around the country. Let me mention one in the violent crime space, and then more importantly, one in the white collar space, which is another one of these practice tips that I think is important. On the firearms space, in the firearms sentencing policy is based in large part on whether a defendant has a prior conviction and whether that prior conviction is for a crime of violence or a controlled substance offense. The Supreme Court, a number of years ago, laid out an approach to determining whether something is a crime of violence or a controlled substance offense called the categorical approach. It is incredibly complicated. It has created what I think are absurd results. It has created lots of disparity and tons of circuit conflicts. I suspect the commission will, at some point, maybe not this year, but at some point, they will have to address that. Now let me turn to another operational issue, which I think may be more important than the white collar part, and that is the status of guideline commentary. Most of you know that the guidelines don't just include base offense levels and specific offense characteristics, but they include lots and lots of commentary, which is used to interpret the guidelines. And in the white collar space, in section 2B1.1, I think that there are 17 pages of commentary, many times the number of pages that are in the guidelines. And that guideline commentary covers many, many important issues, including the definition of loss, whether intended loss is covered. It has all kinds of special rules for particular kinds of white collar crime. Over the past 4 years, the commission has had a quorum. There has been lots and lots of litigation about the validity of that commentary. And there have been a number of courts that have invalidated commentary, including parts of the commentary for white collar offenses in 2B1.1. There are circuit conflicts now about the status of commentary and the validity of commentary. We are going to urge the commission at some point to address that. The Supreme Court has very clearly denied opportunities to resolve those circuit conflicts and are leaving them to the commission to address. So we think the commission needs to look at this and relatively quickly. So let me mention one particular case that you may or may not be aware of. It's called McCarty. It's out of the Sixth Circuit, and it involved a postal worker who was charged with stealing, I think it was thousands of gift cards out of the mail. There is a special rule in the commentary that says those gift cards are to count as $500 in loss for each gift card, regardless of how much money was actually on the gift card. It turned out that most of those gift cards had a value of about $35 a piece. So that special instruction in the commentary raised the offense level for the defendant by a significant amount. The Sixth Circuit ultimately validated that commentary for a variety of reasons. And it is a case that I know has just been of great interest for the white collar bar, and I urge you to read it. There is a more recent case that maybe Jim will talk about involving Judge Casey Rogers from the Northern District of Florida that she wrote and then withdrew, also invalidating commentary. Remember, lots and lots of the rules of 2B1.1 are contained in that commentary, so I do think it's worth a look. Just a few other things we're likely to urge the commission to address. There are lots of crime-specific guideline amendments that we think are necessary. And more importantly, we are approaching the 40th anniversary of the Sentencing Reform Act. And federal sentencing guidelines as a system really has not been reviewed by the commission in quite some time. And so we think that it's probably time for the commission to do that. Since the Sentencing Reform Act was passed and the first guidelines were enacted, there have been a lot of changes in Americans' views towards crime and sentencing. Obviously, the Booker decision changed dramatically whether the guidelines are the law or not law or just advice. All of that has tremendous implications for the structure, the architecture of the federal sentencing guideline system. And we think that it's time for the commission to engage with attorneys, judges, victims, defendants, the public at large, to really look at the federal guideline system, which is quite complicated and really built for a different time, and see whether there are some systemic changes that need to happen. Jim, with that, I think it's 22 after 9. I think I'll stop at this point. And if there are any questions, maybe you can talk about them, but I look forward to hearing from the other panelists.
Great. Thank you, Jonathan. I sure appreciate that. And let me just also briefly mention who the new commissioners are, because I think that's also pretty interesting. There's seven, and by statute, the party in power gets to pick four, but the minority party picks the other three. This is a very interesting looking commission. So the chair is Judge Reeves, who's a district judge in Mississippi. He was the author of the Dobbs opinion in the district court. African-American judge would be the first African-American chair of the commission. There's Judge Restrepo, who's a Third Circuit judge in Philadelphia, who's pretty well known for having started in the entry, did a lot of work on the reentry court there. And has been nominated before. Judge Gleason, former judge Gleason from Brooklyn, who is pretty outspoken on trying to get relief for people under the Holloway case that he wrote when he was a district judge. I think Judge Gleason is a pretty big believer in getting some people out. Also, very interesting, for the first time ever, there is a person, Laura Mate, who at the time she was appointed was a sentencing resource counsel for the Federal Defenders Organization. She resigned from that position, but Laura is basically a career federal defender, someone who has never been appointed to the Sentencing Commission. Now, on the other side, we have a sitting assistant U.S. attorney. Never happened before. So the Republicans selected an active, practicing assistant U.S. attorney in Virginia, a district judge in Kentucky, who I think is fairly conservative, and a woman who was a senior Department of Justice official in the Trump administration. So I think it's going to be a very, very interesting group of votes to see how they interact with one another. The case that Jonathan mentioned, I think you can find it pretty readily on Westlaw. I didn't get to the site because it's already been vacated. Judge Casey Rogers, who's a fairly conservative judge in the Northern District of Florida, had a white collar sentencing, and she ruled in a very detailed, carefully written opinion that the commentary on intended loss is invalid. That intended loss is just not a thing. There's nothing in the law which speaks to loss, meaning loss that didn't happen. The commission just decided to put in their commentary that even if the loss didn't happen, you'd count it anyway. The defendant intended it to happen, and there's nowhere but in the commentary. And so she wrote a carefully worded opinion saying that's invalid. And I think the next day, or maybe 2 days later, she sua sponte vacated her own order, and granted a downward variance to the defendant, which made the whole issue moot. So it's a Judge Rogers opinion from just a few weeks ago. You should go find it on Westlaw, but it's been vacated. Anyway, pretty compelling analysis. Let me go next to Mary. Mary, you just heard Jonathan talk a little bit about what the commission's got in mind for compassionate release. What's been happening, or what do you think will happen, or what can you tell these folks about that?
Wagging my finger at the commission and other agencies for quite a number of years, and it's always been so reassuring to look over and see Jim right there beside me wagging his finger too. We've partnered on a lot of things, from the white collar guideline draft to Clemency Project 2014 to First Step Act implementation. I can't remember all the things we've worked on, but there's not a day that I don't talk to Jim and don't learn something from him. So thanks a lot for including me. So as Jonathan mentioned, we expect that there's going to be a new commission seated and beginning its work by the end of this month. This means the First Amendment cycle since the commission lost its authority to amend the guidelines, since it's lost its quorum, is going to be beginning really soon. I think the stakes for this particular cycle are especially high, and it's not just because of all the things they have to take up. Obviously, they have to.
Excuse me, can you speak up a little bit, please, or bring the microphone closer?
I just need to move it closer. Is that better?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, sorry. I have apparently a low voice, but I don't know.
That's fine.
Family doesn't.
Randy has the opposite problem.
Thank you for bringing it up. Some people just sit back there and get frustrated, so I appreciate that. As Jonathan mentioned, there's a lot of work that needs to be done to address things that haven't been addressed. So, for example, circuit splits, resolving and dealing with statutes that need guideline amendments. Obviously, there's a very, very interesting conversation about the reach of Sentencing Commission guideline commentary. But in my view, the real hot button item for the Sentencing Commission this year is going to be amending the compassionate release policy statement at 1B1.13. And the heat from that comes from a question that has challenged and dogged the commission and all of us for a number of years, which is how much discretion is the commission willing to afford federal judges? And that's been an issue from the very beginning. It's going to be an issue now as we look at how much discretion is the commission going to be willing to afford judges in the compassionate release space. So compassionate release was authorized by Congress a long time ago in the Sentencing Reform Act, and it permits a federal judge to reduce a finalized sentence, which generally can't be done, but reduce a finalized sentence when a person has developed what the statute calls extraordinary and compelling reasons that would warrant that reduction. The statute assigned to the Sentencing Commission the job of describing what those extraordinary and compelling reasons all are. And the current compassionate release statement describes criteria such as medical conditions, advanced age and time served in prison, extraordinary family circumstances, and those kinds of things that can be grounds for a reduction in sentence. In addition, the current policy statement gives the Bureau of Prisons, but not judges, the discretion to identify additional grounds but not enumerated in the guideline. And that's discretion, by the way, that the Bureau of Prisons has never used. It barely uses the discretion it had over the years to release people or to move for the release of people who were dying or very, very ill and debilitated or who had extraordinary violent circumstances. So to understand today why updating the Commission policy statement has come to be so important for judicial discretion and the larger question of who has discretion, it helps to look at what's been happening since in the years that the Commission has lain dormant, and there have been several key developments. First of all, there has been compassionate release litigation, right? For many years, there was no compassionate release litigation because, by law, only the Bureau of Prisons could bring a compassionate release motion, and it rarely did that. And that meant that hundreds of people died in prison waiting for the Bureau to act or because the Bureau had denied, people who Congress believed and the Sentencing Commission believed deserved to go home. The Bureau of Prisons would neglect or ignore or deny those requests. And so in 2018, Congress was fed up with the BOP's heartlessness. And so in the First Step Act, as Jonathan mentioned, it ended the Bureau of Prisons' chokehold on compassionate release. And it did so by amending the compassionate release statute to allow incarcerated individuals to file these motions. And this was a real game changer. In the first year, in 2019, 145, it doesn't sound like a big number today, but 145 people got compassionate release, and that was double the number of anybody who had gotten compassionate release in any year prior to that. The second key event was that starting in March of 2020, obviously the COVID pandemic began to sweep the nation and hit prisons particularly hard. I mean, much, much higher rates of people were getting sick and dying in federal prisons than were dying on the other side. Nobody obviously had anticipated a global pandemic, certainly not the Sentencing Commission. The policy statement was silent on global pandemics or COVID-19 or anything else. Nonetheless, tens of thousands of people filed motions to the Sentencing Commission, to courts, inviting judges to recognize that their vulnerability to serious illness or death due to underlying medical conditions, should they contract COVID, was an extraordinary and compelling reason. And courts agreed. The Department of Justice eventually came around to this position. And grant rates soared. In the period of time since people have been bringing compassionate release motions based on COVID, 4,000 people have received compassionate release. Just an extraordinary number. The third big event that was happening during this period of time while the Commission did not exist in terms of its ability to amend the guidelines is that while all this is going on with COVID motions and so on and so forth, a visionary group of lawyers begins to really move the needle and take compassionate release to an entirely new level. So by statute, as Jonathan mentioned, judges who are evaluating compassionate release motions have to apply applicable policy statements. But because the Commission has not been able to amend the sentencing guidelines since the First Step Act, there's not an applicable policy statement according to most of the courts except for the 11th Circuit, where you are. It's not an applicable policy statement because the policy statement only recognizes motions brought by the Bureau of Prisons and not by individuals, as were authorized in the First Step Act. So what that did was to open the door to permit judges to identify compassionate release grounds other than those enumerated by the Sentencing Commission. And people and their lawyers began bringing motions that invited the courts to reduce extreme sentences. And a number of those were based on the fact that the First Step Act, besides the compassionate release, also reduced some really, really long sentence structures, including for people who received stacked 924C sentences and for people who had 851 enhancements. So what Congress did was to reduce those sentences, but it made those changes prospective only and not retroactive. And so what they did was they left people behind, essentially. And so the courts began getting these motions and began considering whether that was an extraordinary compelling circumstance, that people who were serving sentences that could no longer be imposed today for the very same conduct had been abandoned in prison. And a number of courts, not all of them, agreed. And by our estimate, and it's not a huge number, 230 people have received excessive sentence reductions based on that theory since basically 2020. Obviously, that litigation has spurred a great deal of conversation in the circuit courts, and not all the courts of appeals agree about the extent of judicial discretion. So some courts permit, permit district courts to identify compassionate release criteria without limitations, but others, though agreeing, except for the 11th Circuit, agreeing that judges have discretion to identify compassionate release criteria, nonetheless draw the line at excessive sentences. In other words, they do not allow the judges in their jurisdictions to recognize non-retroactive changes to the statute. So if their reasoning is that the Congress has drastically lowered 924C and 851 sentences, it didn't make those changes retroactive, and courts doing so challenge sort of separation of powers principles and also withdraw the will of Congress. So what's happened is that there's been this very complicated and fractured and multi-layered circuit split that's developed over this issue of how much discretion judges have to identify and to what extent, and whether or not to include, particularly not to include non-retroactive changes made by the First Step Act in the extraordinary and compelling criteria. So the final event that's made this a particularly important, challenging, momentous period is that the Supreme Court has declined to resolve that issue. They have not waded into this conversation. So it really is up to the Sentencing Commission to do it. And they're going to have to craft new, applicable, obviously, policy statement to resolve these differences. And it's going to be faced with a pretty important decision, which is, are we going to preserve the discretion that a number of judges have in this area? Or is it going to constrain that discretion? And if so, by how much? So it's quite important. And I'd like to say one more thing. It's not just about second chances. Judges have been using their discretion in this field for a lot of things that are not enumerated by the Sentencing Commission. So for example, a number of people who were released on CARES Act home confinement, quite a lot of people were released on CARES Act home confinement, a number of them were returned to prison by the Bureau of Prisons for technical or petty violations. Some courts have granted compassionate release to those people because they were facing punishment of years in prison for something that was fairly minor. Other courts have used compassionate release to address the appalling medical conditions so that people are not getting medical care that need medical care in the Bureau of Prisons. And then still other courts are using compassionate release to address other conditions of confinement. And right now, my organization and others are working to bring a new kind of challenge to the courts, and that is to address the impact of sexual abuse in prison. You may have heard about the problems at Dublin and at Carswell, where corrections officials have sexually abused individuals and have been prosecuted for that abuse. But our position is that if the women or the survivors of their sexual abuse don't get Rule 35 motions, and they ought to get compassionate release to begin to help deal with the trauma that they've endured that was not a part of their sentence. The final thing I think I want to say is that there are grounds that we don't even know about and we can't even contemplate. What COVID taught us, one of the things that COVID taught us, is that there's no guideline that can anticipate every single extraordinary and compelling circumstance that's going to happen that would warrant a sentence reduction. Somebody has got to have the freedom and the discretion to determine the next thing that comes along. And right now, the current policy statement only gives that discretion to the Bureau of Prisons. So we think that the judiciary should have the same level of discretion as judges. So I think it's going to be a really important cycle. Keep your eyes out. Participate if you can with commentary, as Jonathan was pointing out. We can write to the commission and tell them what we think. And I invite you all to do so.
What's the best way for attorneys to provide commentary?
Well, go ahead. I would say there's a couple things. First of all, I want to assure you that the American Bar Association, your organization, is going to be involved. So the ABA Criminal Justice Section during the last year passed a new policy statement. Professor Steve Zeidman from Buffalo, I think, he's in Brooklyn Law School, drafted it. And it went through the House of Delegates. So the ABA now has policy to advocate for judges to have the authority to grant these kinds of motions. But anyone can write a letter to the commission And I urge you to do it. They meet them. Put it on your firm letterhead and say, look, this is what I think, and mail it to them. I will say this is not going to be an easy one for the commission. You know, what we have now is a system where pretty much anybody can file one of these motions any day they like. I've heard it sort of sarcastically described that, you know, if you get sentenced on Monday and you don't like it, you can ask the judge to change the mind on Tuesday. And if on Wednesday the judge says no, you can ask him to change their mind again on Thursday. And it may not be that that's actually happening. I think people are not so stupid as to piss off the judge that holds the key to their jail cell. So I don't think actually there's a whole lot of abusive litigation like that that's happening. But you could imagine where the DOJ isn't so thrilled, where there aren't any guardrails on this. So I think that certainly there are certain categories where there shouldn't be any deadline. If it's a health issue, if it's something that's just changed, I think anybody ought to file that at any time. I think that this idea of where we change the law to lower the penalties, but we don't make it retroactive is abominable. And it seems to me that no one should be in prison for a sentence they wouldn't get today. I would hope that those kinds of motions would still be allowed any time. And I think on top of all this, what we haven't been talking about is the idea of just straight up second look. Nothing has changed. It's just the sentence is so long that at some point somebody ought to take another look at it and see if it still makes any sense. So we have authority, we have policy now from the ADA to advocate for that as well. So anyway, it's going to be a fascinating year at the commission to see how this group of seven diverse people address a pretty tricky issue.
And one of the visionary lawyers who brought those motions is John Gleason, who now sits on the commission. And I think is going to keep filing motions.
Yep.
There you go.
Rebecca, tell us a little bit about what to do in your next sentence.
Okay, great. Thank you, Jen, for having me on this panel. It's really an honor to be up here with you and Mary and Jonathan, and to be sitting in between Jim and Mary, two giants in sentencing reform, is truly a highlight. So I hope someone's getting a picture for me. So one thing that I'm working on in my role as co-chair of the ABA Criminal Justice Section Sentencing Committee is a data pilot project. And we are trying to get case-specific data for practitioners. I know there are ways to get general stats. You can find out what percentage of defendants are getting sentenced below the guidelines, but when I'm looking at putting together my sentencing memos, I'd like to be able to get specific cases. And it's pretty difficult. As we all know, 98% of cases plead out, they go to sentencing. Unless something's litigated, it's not getting reported. So if you want to find some similarly situated offender and look at the specifics, it's a painstaking process. You have to search Westlaw, the news, Law 360. I have this crazy thing I do in PACER where you can run a report on your specific statute of conviction and then go case by case. It's really difficult. So Tess Lopez, who is my co-chair, and I have teamed up with these sentencing data experts, Meredith Patty and Mary Kate Rush, and we have put together a survey. And we are trying to get practitioners to self-report. So you should all be expecting an email, hopefully within the next few weeks. The survey is pretty much ready to launch. And we're asking for the case name, the district, offense level, criminal history category, loss amount, it's whatever people can remember. I know everyone's really busy, but you're also asking for enhancements and adjustments, and we've created a survey that's pretty easy to answer. A lot of drop-down menus and some write-ins, and we're hoping to get this data and then make it searchable by practitioners. And one hope is, and you know, a lot of attorneys have big egos and like to brag about their big wins. So we're hoping that the really successful sentencings will come to us, and practitioners can then go and have a much easier time in finding that case-specific data. So that's something that we're really excited about, and it's something that we hope to be able to get out there within the month. I also want to talk about some just general practitioners' tips. You know, there's advocacy at sentencing, involves many different levels of advocacy. So you can start with the probation officer. And one thing that I do is, before the interview, provide the probation officer with basically my own version of the pre-sentence report interview. You can pull up Form 1 on the internet. For clients who can afford it, we actually hire someone who's a sentencing litigation specialist, and they go out, they interview people, they get all these details about your client's life, and they put it into a Word document. So the probation officer, if they would like to, which many times they do, will just copy and paste it and dump it into the PSR. So when you draft your sentencing memo and you want to say, you know, my client's upbringing involved this, or if you want to have certain things about the offense even, you can then cite to the PSR. You're legitimizing your sentencing memo just by getting your story into the PSR. So you can also give letters to the probation officer, which we started doing. Sometimes the probation officer will just attach your submission to the PSR, but most times they actually dump it right in. And depending on the financial situation of the client, it's something you can do yourself or you can hire out. Of course, everyone knows that letters are incredibly important in sentencing. You just want to make sure that they're really specific. You have anecdotes that illustrate the client's good deeds and say more than just, this was a good person. Another sort of new technology is the use of video at sentencing. You can do it, you know, cheaply with an iPhone or iPad and interview people, or there are companies that have more expensive, really well-edited productions they put together, but it's a great way to interview and get stories also about the client and get those before the judge. And when you submit to the judge before sentencing, you can also just explain your, you know, doing this in order to be efficient. And instead of calling these people to speak at sentencing, you're submitting this to the judge. And it's just another layer of getting your client's story before the court. When it comes to the actual sentencing memo, you know, most of us deal with clients who are being sentenced under 2B1.1. And of course, the loss guideline is incredibly flawed. And if you look at the data, the courts who disregard the loss or who stick by the loss guideline are all over the map. And you have really in the Northeast a lot of judges going below the guidelines. Here in Georgia, you have a lot of judges going above the guidelines. But you really want to challenge the guidelines in your sentencing memo. And there are a lot of articles out there. I actually spoke last week with an AFPD up in the EDNY, and he said he doesn't even start with the guidelines anymore. I know a lot of judges won't take well to that, but Jim and Mary both worked on the ABA task force that put together the alternative white-collar guideline a few years ago, and it's a good place to look when you want to go in and challenge the fraud guideline in your sentencing memos. Another thing that I do is a comparison. So you can take your client's offense level. Let's say, you know, you have $2 million loss, and you have this offense level, then you can compare it to all the other crimes that would have that same offense level. And a lot of times, they're pretty horrendous crimes. Terrorism, you know, kidnapping, murder, and you want to compare it to some really violent crimes to show the court this is being looked at the same way this other crime is. You know, another thing is with sophisticated means, technology has really advanced, and a lot of times sophisticated means is being applied where it's not appropriate because what was sophisticated means 10 years ago is no longer sophisticated. And then I have one other little pet project that I'm working on. In the last year, I've seen a lot of women offenders in the news. Of course, we all know about Elizabeth Holmes. Ghislaine Maxwell is not really white collar, but she was in the news, certain Real Housewives. And I thought to myself, this, you know, that women don't really commit these kinds of crimes. There's someone else who's driving the crime and they're, you know, in the passenger seat. So I started looking into it more, and as it turns out, there are increasing numbers of women committing white-collar crimes. And as women are taking on the breadwinner role more and more, the number of women engaging in white-collar offenses is on the rise. There's a huge uptick. And the reasons that women are committing these crimes are the same as men: greed, need for money. And so when you're advocating for women offenders, things that used to be compelling, like are they a caregiver, are no longer that unique. So I'm actually speaking on this in November, so if you happen to be in Washington, D.C. for the ABA fall meeting, come by and you can hear our talk. We have specific BOP issues. You know, speaking to Mary last night about the things that she's working on with sexual abuse, I think also highlights some other issues that may be more specific to women. But we are just analyzing sentencing trends. Are there certain arguments that might be more persuasive with women? I know that, you know, 20 years ago, being a caregiver would be something that was really unique, and it's not something that's that unique anymore for judges or the prosecutors.
Thanks, Rebecca. Let me just ask you, are you all familiar when she mentions the ABA fraud project, are you all familiar with what she's referring to there? So let me tell you, back in 2014, the commission let everyone know they were going to revisit the fraud guideline. And what we have learned from advocating before the commission is that if you wait for them to publish what they're thinking of doing, you're kind of behind the eight ball. So what the ABA criminal justice section did is we put together a group of people to write a fraud guideline for them. We published the product. I think we had a really interesting group of folks. Jonathan was good enough to come and observe for the department. I served as the reporter. Steve Salzberg was our chair. But we had three judges on there you may have heard of: Judge Rakoff, Judge Gleason, and Judge Jerry Lynch from the Second Circuit. And Judge Rakoff, of course, didn't believe in guidelines at all. And we got him to sign on to this. Well, obviously, Judge Lynch got him to sign on. But it's a pretty interesting work product. We have a guideline that fits on one page. It greatly shrinks the loss table. I mean, we still think loss is important. The harm causes is a proxy for culpability. It's just it shouldn't drive it as much as it does. Instead, we introduce a concept called culpability. And we try to look at why did the person do this? And on the high end, there's predatory. That's what I think everybody assumes. Like, the guy intended to steal the money and did. And that was a hard way. I'm going to get money from your pocket and put it in mine. But that just doesn't happen that often, as you all may know. What happens a lot of the times is people who, the next under that was called legitimate ad initio, where people start with a legitimate business. And then as a result of unfortunate and unforeseen circumstances, they get pushed into criminality. And it's just not as culpable as someone who just gets up in the morning and says, I'm going to plan a rip-off. Then the people below that are what we call risk shifters. They really don't want anybody to lose any money. They just want to make sure that if someone loses money, it's not them. The classic being applying for a loan, they're lying about it, but then they try to repay. That's just not as culpable. And at the lowest level, we see people who really are committing what are called gatekeeping offenses. These are just offenses that are there to protect the system. There's no loss. There's not going to be any loss. Nobody's trying to have any loss. So we try to look at those things, because I think those matter to judges. So I will say that the practice tip, I think judges have two questions, and I always try to ask two questions. I think judges want to know, why did you do it, and how do I know you won't do it again? And if you're not answering those questions, you're going to miss it. And you know, these people who we all met, I'm coming in there, and then they blame other people, they won't accept responsibility, and the judges say, well, you don't get it, I don't trust that you won't do it again. I think they need to have those two things answered. I always try to ask, in a guidelines world, what else could my client have done and still scored the same? Because sometimes these fraud guidelines are up so high that you could go through the rest of the manual. I just started 2A1.1 and walked my way through, and by the time I'm done, I can see that my client probably would be 4 levels lower if he had poisoned the public water supply and caused a permanent life-threatening injury to an indefinite number of people for an indefinite period of time, or smuggled every type of illegal firearm on the planet forever. Stealing a nuclear bomb is sometimes lower. Aircraft piracy sometimes lower. Take a look at what else your client could have done and score the same. And then the other question I ask is it really that much worse because of X? When you start with the base and then you describe these various ticky-tack plus twos that get in there, by the time you triple the sentence, but if you you really look at what all the difference is between the base crime and what happened here, it isn't worth that. Ask those questions. How many of you all are familiar with the pattern risk assessment tool that is being used to determine how long your clients will stay in prison? A couple. I'm going to tell you about math this morning. I'm really sorry. But it's what I've got to do.
Strap in, folks.
Because that's what's happening out here, folks. So I'm going to have to rant a bit. Okay, so the First Step Act, one of the things that it did, we've all heard about, is the confession release. It also got rid of some stack 924Cs, made some other very good changes. But a big part of the First Step Act was this huge back-end reform. It directed that there be created a risk and needs assessment system, and that the risk assessment system is a risk assessment tool. I call it a RAT. It's math. It's basically, you take the data of maybe 5,000 prisoners who were released, and you see which of them was citizened, and then what were their characteristics. And you can do a lot of math, and you can come up with some science there. And the idea is that's better than trusting people. And the risk assessment tool was designed and was directed to rank order all prisoners in relation to one another according to their risk of recidivism, and then to put them in four buckets of risk: high, medium, low, and minimal. The prisoners would be evaluated for their needs, and they'd be assigned program that would help address their issues and help reduce their risk of recidivism. And they would be allowed to engage in productive activities that would be good for them. And the idea is that in the First Step Act, for prisoners in that low risk category, for every 30 days they're in a program or a productive activity, they get 10 days off their sentence, or 10 days of earned time credits, which we'll talk about. And those people in that bottom category, minimal risk, they get 15 days off for every 30 days in a productive activity or a program. So on the face of it, it looks like half the prisoners could get out after doing about half to a third of the time. That's what's on the face of this law. And hadn't quite worked out that way just yet. So the law was passed in December of 18. We went to some listening sessions in May of 19. I go for the ADA and NACDL, I should say. I chair NACDL's First Step Act Implementation Task Force and the ADA's First Step Act Implementation Task Force. I'm just stuck in this stuff because I'm just upset about it. And so we went in May, we said, look, this could be racially disparate. We want to know what you're doing. We have concerns about transparency. We want to know how you're going to set these cut points, because cut points are the lines on the page between the categories. The math will tell you how to rank order everybody 1 to 100. There's no math that tells you where to draw the three lines on the page. That's politics. So we expressed all these things. In July, they put out the tool, pattern 1.0, the first version of pattern, July 19. There's a DOJ report, they put it out. We looked at it and thought, wow, should be nice to know how you came up with this. Can we see the data? Can we see what choices were made? No. So the ADA sent a letter. There's a letter from the president of the ADA to the attorney general in August of 19, asking all of our questions. Still waiting a response. We went to more listening sessions in September of 19, and we made these points. We said, look, what are you doing here? This looks pretty rough. They heard us to some degree. In January of 2020, they put out this second version of pattern, pattern 1.2. And they made two changes that they said they made. And I think these are fascinating. One of the factors in the first tool was whether your first arrest was when you were 18 or younger. Well, that's all the black kids. They said, well, let's just not count that. Okay. And in the first tool, there was a benefit if you were allowed to voluntarily surrender. Turns out people that are allowed to be on bond and show up voluntarily at the prison do okay when you let them out. That's all the white guys. So they said, don't count that. We won't count that anymore. I mean, it just puts a spotlight on the idea that math doesn't lie. But math doesn't tell you what to count. And so they said, well, we won't count those things, we'll make it less racist. They made another change to the tool, though, that they didn't actually acknowledge that they made. And that is that they took the number of points for criminal history, which is the biggest factor in the tool, and they multiplied it by 2. They doubled it. And they didn't explain why, and they didn't acknowledge that they did it. The other thing they did, I should back up, in the first version with the cut points, we thought they might draw that middle cut point at the average, what's called the base rate. Nope, they cut that middle line in half the base rate. They just decide, well, we'll just cut that number in half. So with a stroke of a pen, 3/4 of the people roughly are just wiped out of money. That's what they did in the first instance. The other thing that was happening in this time period is that the BOP came out with a rule on how they were going to calculate the credits. Remind you, the statute says if you're in a program for 30 days, you get 10 days or 15 days of credit. BOP says, well, we're going to consider that you have done a day of programming when you've done 8 hours of programming. So if your program meets an hour a week, once you've done 8 weeks of programming, we'll give you credit for 1 day. And that's what they put out. Just gutted it. There was nothing. Nobody getting any credits, don't even bother on that one. And so in November of 20, they put that out for comment. I will say that Mary and I wrote them quite a letter. Others did too, the defenders wrote them a letter. And so the NIJ, the National Institute of Justice, is an arm of the DOJ, but they're pretty apolitical. And they are tasked with the revalidation of pattern and the evaluation of pattern. They put out a report in January of 21 that was pretty interesting. They're like, you know what? This is kind of a racist tool you got here. This thing needs some work. And so we had an election, we had a new administration coming in. Our good friend Mr. Wroblewski there said, you know, Jim, if you really want to get this administration's attention, you probably can put something right. So in March of 21, the ABA task force, and these are all in your materials, we wrote up a report that basically said what I've just told you, and we sent it to the Attorney General. In July, we had a meeting with the Attorney General, our DOJ dialogue group. We mentioned this along with mandatory minimums and the charging policy. What I will say is that they've listened to some degree. So in April of this year, we now have pattern 1.3, a new version of pattern. Now I'm skipping, by the way, the fact that they actually had all these typos and technical glitches, and there were mistakes, and when they even sent the thing out, the score sheets had the wrong numbers in them. So people were just misscored, so they came out with 1.2R in the middle there, the corrected version of pattern. Anyway, now we have 1.3 as of April, and they made some more tweaks. The Attorney General personally looked at the cut points and he moved one of them. And he moved the general recidivism cut point down to put 10% more people in the money. Now there's no explanation of any methodology they use. It's just sausage making. It's just, we decided we wanted to let some more people out, so we moved the cut point. And there's no explanation of what methodology, there's no explanation of why. It's just done. So they moved the cut points down some. They have tweaked some of the definitions. Part of the problem here is that the definition of recidivism is just being arrested, not being convicted. And so we know that there are disparate police practices in communities of color. So it's taking the racist impact of those practices and basically baking it into the tool. So we have just an enormous number of questions and concerns. We think that the data used to train the tool and every decision made to develop the tool should be public. We have shown the world how to lead in imprisonment, and it is urgent. We all know these statistics about how we have 5% of the world's population, 25% of the world's prisoners. I thought some comparative data. Our rate of imprisonment, not numbers, rate of imprisonment, is 6 times that of Canada. And for us to get down to European norms, it would require us to release 80% of our prisoners. Just to get down to the norms of Western Europe, 8 in 10 prisoners would have to walk out the door. That's what we're doing here. We don't know just how ahead of the rest of the world, behind the rest of the world we are, locking people up. This is our opportunity to show the world how to get out of that. This is our opportunity to show the world if you use math and science and you do it smart and it's transparent and every scholar in the world can look at the decisions being made and we study it and talk about it. Not happening. This definition of recidivism needs to be revisited. They are committed, they say, to doing that. The criminal history should be aged. It counts all criminal history as if it just happened yesterday. But the probative value of that fades with time. They are committed to taking a look at that. We think that there are going to be some changes coming. There are some very well-intentioned people working on this now. But it's not easy. Math is hard to fight. You know, it's hard to measure how racist police are. I got to pull those numbers out of my butt. Whereas they've got math on their side. So it's not easy, but this is work that's got to get done. At the end of the day, though, they did change the airtime credits rule. The BOP DOP now has basically adopted the rule we asked them to, for the most part. There's a few things on the edge, but now it matters. Now, if you're in a program and you're doing what you're supposed to do for 30 days, you're going to get 10 or 15 days of earned time credit. And they finally awarded those credits earlier this year. The day that they award those credits, thousands of people walk out the door. This is real. Your clients are not going to do 85% of their time anymore. Now, I represent a lot of rich white guys. I mean, the way it's set up right now, this is the rich white guys relief act. My guys are not going to do 85% of their time. You need to understand pattern. You need to understand the programming. It's about getting your people into the programming. And then the big question is productive activities. What is a productive activity? The statute just says, well, it's an activity that people, you know, do and makes them productive. So I think that's any employment. Apparently, under the new rule, each warden has a considerable amount of discretion as to what they're going to consider productive activity within their facility. My clients are telling me, many of them, that they're getting productive activity credits for their employment. This is a game changer. Your people are going to be getting out early, some of them. And what we need to do is keep an eye on this and make sure it's the right people and that it's under a process that's in some ways defensible. I'm sure we're not quite there yet. Jonathan, I'd like to give you an opportunity for rebuttal on everything that's just been said and tell us when we're going to see the Garland charging memo and what it might say, if you have any idea.
So I'm not going to frame what I'm about to say as rebuttal, because I agree with a lot of what's been said. But I have taken some notes as everyone, so let me just address some of them, maybe in reverse order. So I'll start with Jim and pattern. I think it's fair to say that this administration is fully committed to complete, robust implementation of the First Step Act, and that includes eliminating any unwarranted racial disparities and impacts of the pattern tool, ensuring that there's support for prison programming, full and complete implementation of the prison credits program. And as Jim said, there are a lot of tricky issues. The one thing I can say procedurally is that the department is engaging with the best experts and also with outside interest groups. And so I just think that we're all going to be struggling with this for some time, but I think it's fair to say that the administration is really committed to it. On what Rebecca said on the data project, I think it's a fascinating project that she's working on, and I think it's really, really important. But one thing I think is really important to keep in mind, judges and probation officers vary dramatically around the country in terms of their approach to sentencing, their approach to the guidelines, what's important to them in sentencing advocacy. Many judges, like I think someone mentioned in the Eastern District of New York, yes, a lot of judges in the Eastern District of New York don't even look at the guidelines manual. They just start on their own. But there are other districts, some of them in Georgia, where they do look very closely at the guidelines manual and hew to it pretty closely. So I just think it's really important that if you're practicing in some district that's not your home, that you find like a local counsel or somebody that can advise you of what the practices are, not just in the district, but with a particular judge, because it often differs judge to judge. And that includes, as Rebecca said, participating in the development of the pre-sentence report. There are some districts where they ask the AUSA on the case to send them their file, and that becomes the factual foundation for the PSR. In other districts, there's an opportunity for lots of other people to be involved. In other districts, the probation officer is him or herself involved in investigating the case almost de novo. So it really, really matters what the individual judge, individual probation officer, what the district's probation practices are, and we urge you to find out as much as you can as you delve into this process that will lead to a lot of sentence report and ultimately a sentencing hearing and a sentencing post. And finally, two more things. One, Mary talked a lot about compassionate release. Just to give you a little insight about what happens at the Justice Department when a new piece of legislation passes that's going to have a big impact, there's a group of people that sits around and tries to identify all the ambiguities and help decide what the department's litigating position is going to be addressing all those ambiguities. So one, of course, on compassionate release after the First Step Act was whether or not the guideline 1B1.13, which the commission passed some years ago to address compassionate release, and frankly, that puts substantive limits on what compassionate release is, whether that applies. And of course, our position, our litigating position, is yes, it does, and we lost that in every circuit except one. But despite the fact that that guideline does not apply in every circuit but one, there were subsequently a number of appeals on specific issues. So Mary mentioned Judge Gleason's Holloway project and this question of whether compassionate release can be used to apply retroactively some of the provisions of the First Step Act that the Congress decided not to apply retroactively. And there's a circuit split on that. Some circuits said yes and some circuits said no. The big question, and this is one of the places where I tend to differ, I'm not sure how much, but I tend to differ a little bit with Mary, and that is whether or not there are going to be either procedural or substantive limits on compassionate release beyond the words extraordinary and compelling. And Mary makes a good point that under the current guideline, if the Bureau of Prisons thinks it's a good idea, then it's encompassed by the guideline. And she says, well, logically, why not have that also apply to judges? Well, one reason is because the Sentencing Reform Act, when it was passed, deliberately, very consciously, and very importantly, eliminated parole. And the Sentencing Reform Act was all about creating a determinate sentencing system. And by that, and this is all laid out in congressional legislative history, the idea was that when a sentence is imposed, by and large, not completely, that sentence is final. The Act, of course, does recognize this safety valve called compassionate release, but it specifically directed the Sentencing Commission to lay out what are the substantive limits on compassionate release in the guideline, and also specifically to lay out examples of what is and isn't compassionate release. So, I think Jim and Mary are right. This is not an easy issue. I think there's going to be a really significant debate within the commission this first year about what kind of procedural or substantive limits to put on compassionate release beyond the words extraordinary and compelling. Frankly, for me, the only word that really matters is extraordinary. I mean, I don't think you have to tell a judge not to grant a motion if the argument is not compelling. So to me, compelling doesn't add a whole lot. But so what is extraordinary and what isn't? That's something I think the commission is going to have to address. One last thing that I just want to mention, and that is there is a chance that at the end of this year, after the election, that Congress is going to take up some kind of criminal justice reform legislation. I mention it because if they do, and if some of the bills that they've been considering over the course of this last Congress actually get enacted, it could have implications for your practice. Some of those bills include legislation that passed the House, which would eliminate the use of acquitted conduct in sentencing. There's legislation that would equalize penalties for crack and powder cocaine. There are a number of bills addressing in-prison programming, including elderly offender programming, and that's something that is not unique to the white collar space, but disproportionately present in the white collar space. So I mention it. I think it's worth just keeping an eye on, and we'll see what happens. That's it, Jim.
Thanks, Judge. I think we have a question in the back.
Yeah, can you tell me with this compassionate release, if you're taking into consideration the fraud that's occurring in prisons for unemployment insurance and other federal programs to the tune of over $31 billion with a B in California and somewhere in the neighborhood of $90 billion for the entire U.S. that we know about, that in fact was paid for a quote-unquote unemployment. Is that compassion release factor into it with that kind of outrageous payments being made to prisoners?
I'm not sure I understand it. Who's paying prisoners?
Federal government, unemployment insurance, also American Rescue Plan, federal programs. $87 billion right now, and you don't even know about it. That's how egregious this is.
Well, I'm just not sure what exactly you referred to. What I think I can answer is that I don't know that that would really come up in a compassionate release case unless it's related to that particular defendant. I would think, obviously, if there was evidence that that defendant had engaged in some, you know, really bad
fraud. Well, since they missed this for several years now, I don't even know if this is in the radar screen, but this has come up now. The governor of California, Gavin Newsom, has acknowledged it, and also the federal government has acknowledged it as well, too. So federal funds as well as state funds for unemployment.
$97 million. Yeah, I mean, maybe I should go to jail and make more money. It sounds like.
I have a question about people who are
in
office
say there was some talk about a criminal history of Category 0 years ago. What, Mary, what do you remember about that?
I vaguely remember. Jonathan, do you know what happened to that?
I will say, I think Judge Gleason will be a very sympathetic ear on that point. What I have... So the commission has a public affairs address. If you go on the commission's website, it's pretty clear how you can submit comment. The fact they haven't...
Jim, if that question was directed to me, you want to hear it, so if you can repeat it for me.
Jonathan, I think the concern is, you know, that some of us, when we ask the commission to do things, they just don't do it. So what's the most effective way to get them to pay attention to what we want them to do? And it specifically is in the question of the sort of true first offender, the 994J point, that people who have zero criminal history are just different. We're sort of simultaneously trying to remember what happened with that. It seemed to me there was some talk years ago about a criminal history category 0. And then the other question is, if we want to bring that issue back up, Amy's question is, you know, what's the most effective way to try to really get that teed up for the commission?
So with any issue, to get it teed up to the commission, it's not just sending them a letter. That's the good start. It's the minimum that needs to be done. But I think working with some of the other advocacy groups, other institutions that regularly appear before the commission will help and make it more likely that the commission takes it up. So just as an example, the commission has a number of advisory groups. There's something called the Practitioners Advisory Group, which is frankly a non-public defense lawyers. And I think if this becomes a priority for the Practitioner Advisory Group, and they put it in front of the commission, and the ABA follows up with a similar request, and you follow up with a similar request, I think it's going to have a much greater chance of getting considered by the commission. In terms of criminal history zero, the commission has done a number of studies, which you can find on their website, about criminal history score and recidivism rates and lots of other things related to the criminal history score. And there was some consideration about a new criminal history category or departure. Judge Gleason is particularly interested in and has written about the fact that there's a directive in the Sentencing Reform Act that says that if you're a first-time nonviolent, non-serious offender, or if you've committed a non-serious offense, or an otherwise, something like that, I don't know the exact words, but it's in Title 28, Section 994, the presumptive sentence should be probation. Of course, what is the rub there is what's a serious offense, and in the white collar space, typically the commission has looked to the amount of loss as the dividing line. So under a certain amount, it's a less serious offense, and over a certain amount, it's a more serious offense. But I do think there's a possibility the commission will take this up in the next couple of years, and I think that possibility will, the likelihood will increase if there's efforts made with the advisory groups and various advocacy groups to raise it together.
It's 994J, and it basically says for a first offender who's been nonviolent or not otherwise serious offense, that the commission should set up these. It's a directive to the commission to write guidelines so that the presumption would be probation for that kind of.
Does ADA policy allow, do you think that there's no flexibility to include that in the prior?
I think so. So, Amy, the issue there is for ADA to go to bat on it, we have to have policy, and we would just have to look and see whether we think ADA's policies cover that. I just don't know. Deciding what's an otherwise serious offense when they're setting this through those loss tables, they're not distinguishing between a true first offender and anyone else. Anyway, what I could say is what Jonathan has said. I think Judge Gleason in particular has spoken to this point. I know that when we were writing our draft guideline, by the way, I should say the name of the group is the ABA Criminal Justice Section Task Force on the Reform of Sentencing for Economic Crimes. And our report should be fairly readily accessible on the ABA Criminal Justice Section's website. If it's not, let me know, and I'll try to improve its visibility. But our report and our draft guidelines should be pretty readily findable on the ABA Section's website. But we did put a thing in the end, and I think it was really Gleason pushed it, that said something to the effect that for a first offense, it was not, I forget exactly how we drafted, but we essentially parroted that there's a separate in out. And there's basically, you just don't even look at prison. It's a first offense, and it's not a serious offense. And that was in the law. They just, their method of implementing that wasn't really all right. I know that, Mary, you've got plenty of that.
Yeah, I think the federal public defenders in their letter are also going to be talking about the impact of criminal history, and we can check and see if they're going to address catholicism, and that's it.
Yeah, I would say talk to them, try to get the defenders going too.
Thank you for raising it. Appreciate your advocacy.
And it's this annual cycle that John was talking about. So it's a pretty limited time period, a particular time of the year when you want to hit this. And this compassion release thing is going to be on fire, and it's going to be on fire to hurt. It's going to be move hurt now. They're going to be publishing something in December or January. They haven't even met yet. So the month of October and November is going to be all hands on deck on this board, I think. So any of you all and Laura get involved in this advocacy, let us know. And we're going to be trying to put together a pretty good letter. And we're always looking for more bodies to help command the rules. Other questions? Well, I think no one would probably object if we end a few minutes early. And thank you so much for your participation. Did you want to
make a pitch? Just quickly, I was talking about this kind of new project that we're doing to try and sort of open some new ground and secure compassionate release for people who have endured sexual abuse in prison. All of the work that we all do on the Jim's firm just took a case, we place these cases with pro bono lawyers and the federal public defender. So if anybody's interested in trying to break some barrier and new ground on this issue, let me know and we can.
This group will support you with incredible resources. So, Jonathan, thanks again for your participation. Thank you to the members of the panel. It's a pleasure to be here.